Hello, everybody. I hope everybody can see and hear me. If not, please let me know through the chat. Hi, my name is Anne. I'm the communications officer for NEMO, the Network of European Museum Organizations. Okay, apparently you can hear me, so that's a good sign. This is our seventh webinar overall, and the first one in, I call it the NEMO year, which means we were selected in the Creative Europe program, and that means we are co-funded for the next 4 years, and the first year just started on April 1st. So this is the first webinar of this year. There will be three more, and we have a lot of other different activities which we are happy to inform you about. So consider checking our website or signing up for our newsletter if you haven't already. But this webinar is not about NEMO, it's about the great revolution of European museums. And Massimo Negri, he will be the facilitator of today's webinar. We're very fortunate to have him here. And if you don't know him, which I assume you do, he's, among other things, the director of the European Museum Academy and also the author of the book, The Great Revolution of European Museums, which is the basis kind of the webinar that he will give today. I think it's very important to look at the past of museums to be able to discuss the future. And so this is a good beginning to start a discussion on the matter. Referring to discussing this matter, if you do have questions or if you just want to make comments, the chat is the place to go for this. I can already see what you're writing, and Massimo can do the same. So he will reply to your questions, but at the end of the webinar, so we don't get confused if too many questions arise throughout. Other than that, two more organizational things. If you're interested in the presentation, it will be uploaded on NEMO's website after the webinar. I will also post the link in the chat at the end of the webinar. And if you want to review this webinar, then you can also do that within the next few weeks. We'll upload it. Thank you all for joining this webinar, and I think I'll just give the virtual stage to Massimo, who will give us an insight into the experience he has collected over the past 40 years by being a juror in for several museum prizes, among them the European Museum of the Year Award. So Massimo, the stage is yours. Thank you all for joining.
Good afternoon. Thank you for attending this event. Many thanks to NEMO and the other. And for 10 years, I'm also the director of these awards. And later, again, I'm still in the Nobel, the MICC award, which is the only one about industrial and technical museums. In other terms, it's based on a practical observation, if not day by day, but almost over the years, about transformation, changes, evolution in the museum world, because all these schemes were devoted, still are, to new museums. This means that personally, I've been involved in the assessment process. Doesn't mean necessarily to have visited all of them, but the assessment project and visited many of them, or about so far 2,000 museums of any kind in Europe. I'm not telling this for narcissistic attitude, but simply because the problem with awards is that the material you gather, and especially the experience that you do, in some sense is very volatile. It is temporary. Say every year you have a new edition of the award, which means that you start from zero in some sense, or whatever you have been collecting, accumulating of knowledge and materials remains on the backgrounds, but it's There are rare occasions, and there is not a framework to make it accessible to other people, to other colleagues, but in general to other people. For instance, Enya published every year a brochure about the candidates, distributed it, but don't forget that in 83, for instance, when I started, internet not only didn't exist, but nobody could have imagined, even imagined about the internet. We were pre digital era. So it came a moment when I felt the other aspect is my work at the university. I felt under, in some sense, the stimulus, the pressure of teaching, especially in course of museology, that now from this year is also available on it's in two formats, one in presence and the other one online. So if you are interested in what I'm gonna say and you want to go in depth, and you could have a look at the website of the University in Milan and to know how this online course is structured. And I felt the necessity of a book where it was in some sense summarized, distilled the main things that have been accumulating during the years and made them available to the public. And this, the title in some sense inevitable. Why? Because these awards were focused on new museums and as well as on museums with radically changed, reshaped. The panorama is that the museum world in Europe is not at all a dusty and slow moving, hesitant or lazy world, as in the public imagination frequently happens to be imagined or represented, but on the contrary, it's a very dynamic sector. Just to give you an idea, in 1970, which is of course a long time ago, but it's not centuries ago, it was estimated there were about 18,000 museums all over the world. Only in Europe, we estimate now 40,000, and the Washington Post wrote that only in the United States, all the Starbucks and McDonald's put together are less than the United States museums. What it means? It means that the recent decades have been characterized by a growing, endless growth, quantitative growth of museums in any sector. As it happens with this kind of phenomena, when you have quantitative growth, this goes together with the qualitative changes, not necessarily growth, but changes. I put here just with the deliberate intention to create, which is one of the main target of this talk, to create a certain chaos in your mind, in the sense that when you have to do with magmatic material, magmatic phenomena, it's better that you leave apart only all the worries about to find, say, to define categories, and first start from the observation. It meant that this process had brought to the birth of new concepts, for instance, museum that had defined of ideas, the Museum of Health, or the Swarovski Crystal at the Company Museum of the famous Swarovski, focused on the spiritual, symbolic, imaginific aspect of crystals, but created by a company with company purposes, or as in the first two cases, the Imperial War Museum North in Manchester and Flanders Field Museum, a radical revision of an old tradition of typical military museum re-edited with new visions. This process of innovation has also included, as I said, existing museums, which has radically changed their shape. Probably the most typical example of a museum of tradition which has radically changed some aspect are the British galleries in V&A, the door on areas like the backstage of the museum, for instance, it's becoming relatively, say, popular, the fact of opening storages, but it remains a turning point, what happened about 15, 20 years ago in Netherlands at Enkhuizen. I don't know if still there is that gallery, where a gallery of about 1,000 square meters was devoted to what is the work of the museum, but behind the scenes, what happens, because it is strange, but in general, the public knows or have an idea of what happens behind the scene in a library, in a school, in a theater, any cultural institution, but what happens in a museum is very mysterious. And even, for instance, how it is built up, the exhibition is created, the experience of which people do when visiting the museum, the museum environment, which remains rather obscure to most of the people, even to people who like very much, so feels more familiar than the general public. It has meant, among the other things, for instance, unusual places to be converted into a museum. One of the most unexpected being probably a swimming pool, a larger Arnovo swimming pool, La Piscine, in Roubaix. And this has also brought to a redefinition, if you want, of both sides, the audience, for instance, the theme of comfort, physical for comfort of visitors, the behavior, and also on the side of the curators. And we will come back to that later. This global change has affected any aspect of the structure of the museum as well as the life of the museum, from the hardware, say, conservation techniques, materials, banana, but digital printing has allowed the things that only 5 or 7 years ago were not possible, for instance, to print on any kind of materials, steels, and so on, and any kind of almost of sizes, and high definition in quality, visual quality, but also in terms of contents, and which is not a minor aspect, organization, for instance, the redefinition of human resources. The crucial point of management and finance, which has brought in various cases to the emerging of new models, not to say about architecture. I here put together some pictures which are symbolic of these kinds of changes. Iron Bridge was the first winner of the European Museum of the World in 1917. I was not the judge at that time. But why? Let's say, not only because of the theme, but for a simple reason, and which was in some sense industrial heritage, which in the hierarchy of cultural values, for instance, in Italy, the first book about industrial archaeology was published 1 year later. In England, it has already certain short tradition, but also for a practical aspect. How to create a museum where the main piece of the collection is a bridge? The bridge is still in use. The problem in itself was not totally new, because, for instance, Kansen was already an example, but that was the category of open air museum, where you dismantle an architecture, you rebuild it in another place, and is no longer in use, in situ. But here the point was a museological and museographical complicated problem, and it has established, if not a model, because it was rather controversial at the beginning, but it has represented very much a turning point in the physical dimension of the idea itself of the museum. At the opposite, in some sense, not the opposite because of the size, say, of the linguistic of the museum, and we will come back again to the use of this term, the linguistic. I put a picture of the museum in order, the museum of the mind, and it, more specifically the room devoted to Freud. First of all, the museum of the mind, so it's a theme. And the theme is not in itself generated by the fact that the museum has a collection, but is a deliberate thematic cultural choice. Then the collection is at the service of a thesis, if you want, of the communication of a theme. And then, but it is also interesting, you put this picture here because I want you to think a little bit about the way this is presented, a very important subject is presented, Freud. You speak of mind and instinctively comes to your mind the name Freud. And here what you have. You have an object which is symbolic. It's not the original. The original one is not is in the house of in London, because also in the Freud Museum, indeed, if I'm not wrong, it's not the original one. It is a couch, a sofa, the famous sofa of the technique used by Freud. And then a picture of him and some visual representation of possible visual translation of the brain movements. And that's it. Say, it's a very conceptual presentation, which we can assume as a significant example of one of the things that has happened in terms of exhibition planning or exhibition creating. Very conceptual, or very spectacular, like another museum which I consider a turning point, the Imperial War Museum North in Manchester, designed by Libeskind, which is an outpost of the Imperial War Museum in London. But its name is very meaningful because of the museum, because the name is War Shapes Lives. So it's totally different from the traditional museum of military history based on battles and so on, military and so on, based on an idea again, and it is how war affects the life of the ones who are not in the battle, in general, of society. And it's a very spectacular museum. These silos, they are called, these walls are about 10, 12 meters high. And these two pictures give you an idea of that is only one object in this arena, for instance, only one object, nothing special, not particularly monumental. How is different the perception according to the changes in the visual context, which is very involving and very impressive. As a footnote, these are not digital pictures. These were just projected by an old fashion at the beginning when it was created, called a carousel projectors, like a set. Very complicated to be done at that time. A masterpiece in itself. And again, representative of a different conceptual approach and also in terms of presentation. Very innovative. Sometimes these innovations have generated a new species of museum. The Haus der Geschichte in Bonn was the museum about the history of the reunification, in some sense, the post-war history of the federal, at that time, Federal German Republic before the reunification. And it has generated other house of histories in Leipzig, in Germany, but also as a model in other countries. What was the aspect, the main aspect that is this? To deal with history which is closer to the present. In other terms, in general, in museums, we deal with history, but the generation where the protagonists are dead, are no longer alive, are no longer directly witnesses are no longer directly involved in the audience. Here, it's a museum of contemporary history in the most contemporary sense of the word, which means that most of the things that have been said are still in the scope of the experience of the audience, so are in some sense questionable, in the sense that there is a more direct relationship, in the sense of a more risky relationship between the museum, the exhibition, and the audience. This theme of the controversial, if you want, heritage and the controversial things is very made very clear as an example by the House of Terror in Budapest, which was opened immediately some years after the end of the communist regime. And what we have here as again different keys of interpretation of this picture, because from one side, from the strictly point of view of the exhibition, again adopts the techniques more of an installation of contemporary art than of an illustrative, pedagogical, or strictly, say, explanatory presentation. It's a very emotional presentation. And the House of Terror, the name in itself, but it's not a name which was invented to define the museum. It was the name used by the people in Hungary, because this was the building before of the political police of the Nazi party, the local Nazi party during the Nazi occupation, and then it was turned into the headquarters of the political police of the communist regime. So it, unfortunately, a very gloomy continuity. The fact in itself to create such a museum has generated a debate which still is not finished and generates very radical reactions, and introduces us to these two points. On one side, the way of communicating, and the other side, the thesis in itself is a political museum. Where there is a thesis of the continuity, in some sense, of the general framework of these two regimes, and offers us a case for something that we will take into account later, again, about the political meaning of the museum, contemporary museum. Moving to a totally different subject, in Barcelona, Cosmo Caixa is a big museum, which is a mix of Museum of Natural History, Museum and the Science Center, a big thing, located in partially in a former beautiful building, industrial building, textile building, and with modern addition. And it includes, it's the only museum in Europe, including a portion of a rainy forest, living rainy forest, where it rains every 10 minutes, and it's not large, but it's not that small. And it offers to visitors the direct experience of a living environment. It's not a museum, traditional museum of natural history, it's not a science center, it is unique. It is not a minor experimental thing, it is a source of inspiration for anybody who wants to create something dealing with the problems of the past and the future of our planet. There are some places, like this one, for instance, which is our Lord in the Attic, which is a church which was a clandestine, some hidden church, Catholic church created by a Dutch, an Amsterdam Dutch merchant when the Protestant took over. This museum has been recently renovated. This is an interesting case because typical museum which substantially meant to preserve in situ a special place, but now that it has been renovated with its entrance, the cafe and so on, has lost some, in my view, something of its magic. Although, from the technical point of view, is more, say, accessible and open to the public. This means that not always innovation, it's my opinion, of course, but innovation is always twofold. It's always a risky business, in some sense. The swimming pool I mentioned before, and this is a watch, an observation tower with, on the Slovenian border with Italy, which defines itself the smallest museum in the world. Tomtits Experiment is a museum in Sweden, where it's a science center, but includes a kindergarten, not just an area for children, but where regularly children. And now, if not wrong, they have also installed first two classes of the, if I'm not wrong, of the elementary school. In other terms, is the symbol of the most integration possible, one of the most possible integration between the educational side and the exhibition environment. But this kind of revolution has meant also new kinds of heritage. We mentioned some of these new kinds of heritage, and of course the museum building, that the heyday of museum buildings, the golden era of museum architecture, one could say. Renzo Piano defined the museum, say the museum is a place where one should lose one's head, which of course is a nice definition, imaginative definition. But the point that I submit to your attention, not having an answer for the moment, is that if we go back to the first part of the 19th century, it happened something similar. Schinkel, Sohn, Smirk built the Art Museum, the British Museum, and so on. They became for 100 years a model. What of these mushrooming of new architectures in museum is destined to become a model, or not? It's a question that we will see, but it should be interesting to come to some, sooner or later, that's the moment that perhaps we come to some conclusions. The theatrical aspect of the museum. Again, a very interesting example. First of all, this is, because of the subject, is the Buddenbrock House in Lübeck. And it represents one of the crucial scenes of the novel. First point, the Buddenbrock never existed. A museum, by definition, deals with a real phenomenon, or a real event, or a real a category of objects, say, collection. Here, nothing is real for the simple reason that the subject itself never existed. So, and it is not a unique case, but it's very representative of, you know, the fact that you go back and you want to see the Buddenbrock. And so a museum is created about a story. Of course, there is a part devoted to the two brothers, Mann, but and it is very theatrical. It's theatrical because the scene, conceived the imagination of the writer, is theatrical, and also for because the representation is theatrical. It's also theatrical the way you use, for instance, in the Bach House, the house where Bach lived most of his life in Germany, this way of proposed of listening in these eggs, listening to music in itself, is, if you want, a trick to engage people. It's different to listen to music sitting on a sofa, it's different to standing or sitting in a chair. It's mostly different in this sort of capsule, which gives you a sense of instability, but at the same time a sense of intimacy. It is again part of the, this kind of theater games, which becomes reach its climax, if you want, when you experience digital installation, multimedia installation. This is the museum devoted to an Italian political figure, De Gasperi, one of the father of the European Union community, and is there is nothing left of his birth, I mean, just the house, nothing, no objects. This is the room where he was born, and it's a full immersion multimedia installation. One could say, well, it's a total manipulation, it's totally, nothing is real here. But I want to quote here one of our the founders, indirect founders of the European Museum Academy, because he was one of the European Museum the Year Award, the European Museum Forum, which I've been a director and had the privilege to work with him for many, many years, Kenneth Hudson, who say the tiger museum is not a tiger, it's a tiger in a museum, which is profoundly true, and that we from time to time tend to forget. The museum is always the result of the work of manipulation. So it's a waste of time saying, it's like when you write an article from a newspaper or for any form of communication, there is always a large aspect of interpretation, deliberate or not. So it's useless to talk about the misleading aspect of the use of digital techniques, because it's simply an evolution of what museum has always been doing. But this curiosity, in 1909, the director, if I'm not wrong, or those years, the director of the Boston Art Museum wrote this long article that you can find on the internet, and they strongly suggest about the so-called museum fatigue, which is documented very much by pictures which are still very instructive. But of course, also with different museums, the evolution of the museum environment, we have the emerging of new forms of museum fatigue, especially from the intellectual point of view. Also because the visitors, it's no longer a matter of visitors, but it's a matter of users. Users, not only because the users, physical users, people who go to the museum to do something, not only to visit, perhaps not even visiting, but profiting of facilities of the museum, but of course the great new theme of the online users. But the museum is not, of course, an isolated institution. It is fully immersed in social context. And there are three sociological evolutions that I wanted to submit to your attention, because in my view are especially impacting on museums users, not only museum visitors, and will also influence it very much. The first is the millennium of cities. For the first time in human history, most of the more than 50% of the people living on our planet lives in cities. It means in places that by definition are the places of exchange. And the second is the fact that we have, in 10 years, we had, not in 2050, only in the last 10 years, we had an enormous growth of the population who is older than 100 years. It's no longer something special, which means that going back means 80s or 90s. In other terms, for the first time in history, we have four generations living on the same altogether living and acting on the same stage, including the museum stage, not because our museums are so crowded with people older than 100 years, but say many who are from 70s later. And the third is, on the opposite, the millennium of the millennials. And the millennials are a breed very difficult to define. These three aspects gives you an idea of the segmentation of the audience. At the same time, the segmentation of the same time, the fact that all these segments are influencing each other and especially asking to museums for something. It's a galaxy in movement. New kinds of heritage, this is very curious, is the cheese, Welsh cheddar cheese. The mine is only in a place which is very proud of this mining tradition, although most of the mines are closed, could use as a marketing for cheese the dirty face of the miner. But just this to say that remove the museum is in the middle, the definition of the meanings of the heritage, for instance, heritage marketing, in this case, the industrial world, or the digital, this Cleveland Museum of Art, Institute of Art, with its great wall at the beginning, touch screen, or the more traditional presentation, or for instance, the different languages used, like for deaf people. I mean, in all this redefinition of roles and techniques and themes and architecture, is there space again for a method? Yes and no? Yes, I think yes. And one source of inspiration for me, my experience and my view, is the thinking of Jerome Seymour Brunner, who luckily for him also belonged to this generation of centenary people, died last year, almost 101. And here's a theory of the narrative construction of reality could be very useful in terms of imagining exhibition and planning, especially exhibition. In other terms, to banalize, if you want, the thoughts by Brunner, is a movement from the logic scientific mode, which is based on a sound argument, tight analysis, reason, proofs, Aristotelian logic, to a narrative mode, which is in some sense the first way to learn, and to more than to learn, to approach the reality, and which is very true in our own experience. Introduce another thing that we find in a few seconds, the storytelling aspect. The where a strategy is no longer the sound argument, but the good story. The inspiration and the mechanism where you have association, aesthetic and intuition, interacting. I'm not saying that one is radically alternative, and the two things can coexist, but what Brunner has added is this part, and this part, in my view, is very useful. In marketing, there is a bit old-fashioned now, but there was a term, there is still a term, jargon of marketing, which is also useful for us to define the method, and it is the acronym is AIDA. What do you have here? AIDA stands for when you have to sell something, you raise attention. If you don't raise the attention, there is no chance. Consolidate the attention into interest, promote the evolution of the interest into desire, which in the end comes to an action. The action is buying in marketing. Here you can put whatever you want, learning or doing something. But the curve, the structure, the consequential sequence of these steps, if you think about it, it's very appropriate also to what happens in museums, where the main starting point is always curiosity, intellectual curiosity. And then perhaps you go in depth, and then the desire to participate, to do something, or just to go beyond the simple contemplation. In terms of museum and museological thinking and museography, this means what I have defined the long march from collection interpretation to imagination. The collection interpretation was a term that interpretation itself, we can associate with the creation of the interpretation department in the Science Museum when Neil Cossos, who was the founder of Iron Bridge, incidentally, became the director. There is a book very interesting, Behind the Scene by Sharon McDonald, if I'm not wrong, behind the scene at the Science Museum, where she explains what happened when this department of interpretation was established. This was in the early 90s, if I'm not wrong. From the early 90s, we can say there is a sort of evolution in terms of the vision of the use of the collection, and not only the collection, all the available resources from interpretation to communication, to experience, the famous lecture by Daniel Serotta, director of the Tate, experience of interpretation. It's focused on art, but it's full of suggestions in general. You can find it easily, I suppose, also on the internet, as a lecture. To imagination, we could say. I don't know if imagination could be with several question marks, but I hope that this gives you an idea of the kind of evolving process. I have put here, trying to simplify for the ones who are interested, unfortunately, again in Italian, but then I give you some suggestive readings. Wrote a book about 10 years ago, an handbook of museology, where nothing very, just short, relatively short, where I tried to put, to conceptualize, and later I found that, of course, no more is original, and I'm very happy that I found somebody else who shared very much my impressions and my opinions in this field. And first, the conceptual side, the concept, the basic idea. Then the narrative, which makes intelligible this concept, the community. Then, what happens in the museum? So, the distribution of space according to the different types of activities that the museum intends in, under the physical possibilities and the financial possibility to. So, the machine, if you want, the physical machine. In this physical machine, in this physical space, you put what you have elaborated here. And this becomes the thematic plan, distribution. And then you put the collection at the service of this, and not vice versa. Till 20, 30 years, 40 years ago, the first point was here. And the rest came. It was exactly the opposite. But this is the result of this, one of the results of this revolution. It is basically based on this, on the growing importance of storytelling. Storytelling has become, when in marketing, especially the internet, the explosion of the media, the screen media, as determined an explosion of storytelling in our life. It's not a matter limited to museums. It's in all our life, from when we start the day, our daily life. It has been estimated by some research center in the United States that we meet around 70 screens every day. I don't know if it is true or not, but 35 are largely enough for me. But I'm sure that each of us as a dialogue or a passive experience with every day with dozens and dozens of screens, each of them telling a story. Once said this, it remains true that our battlefield is the museum environment. And the museum environment, not just space, something larger, is a growing, can be defined as a growing complex communicative sequence of spaces, physical spaces, with a very multifaceted linguistic. It's complicated. Life has become complicated, as it is in general. How can we cope with this challenge? It's not only a matter, as Renzo Piano said, with all the respect, a matter of architecture and interior design. States. Finished the era of the dictatorship of the architects, which of course is very much still, especially in art museum, but it's an interdisciplinary teamwork. It's banal again to be said, but when you put this in practice, it has a strong consequences. Keeping in mind one point that Isaac Singer very well put on in the 70s when accepting the Nobel Prize. The narrator of our age, as in every other age, must be an entertainer of a spirit in the fullest sense of the word, and just not a bitch. There is no heaven for bored readers, and no excuse for tedious literature. So if we put instead of readers, there is no heaven for bored visitors or bored user museum users, and no excuse for tedious museums, it is very true. In this sense, it's very strange that still museums are underestimating literary sources. There are a lot of museum buildings with literary, we have offered an example with the Budenbrock with literary authors. But I give you an example. You deal with a complex subject like Stalinism. If you go to read three books, Grossman, Life and Destiny, Solzhenitsyn, One Day in the Life of Ivan Denisovich, and the letters by the daughter of Stalin, Svetlana, letters to a friend, you have a minor material enough to involve to communicate and to involve your visitor much more than quoting statistics, historic facts, which of course are useful, are essential, are important, but be sure that literary sources in a context where the main focus, right or wrong, is the narrative side, is strange that museums are very much focused on the narrative side and still do so little use of the narrative material which is in literature. Perhaps Wolfgang von Goethe was quite pioneering when wrote, a museum should never be finished, but boundless and ever in motion. This is a poster from an American museum, taken Hammer Museum, I don't remember where it is in the United States. It's still very modern, this definition. You will find, I'm not reading them, but because I will give you the presentation, some readings if you are interested in this. Some of them you can find also for free somewhere as a PDF. Some you can find on Amazon almost for very little money. Some, on the contrary, expensive because I consider rare books. But two certainly, Social History of Museums and Museum English, influenced by Kenneth Hudson, especially Social History of Museums, is still very informative. The Total Museum by Jorge Wagensberg, the creator of Cosmo Caixa. Mastering a Museum Plan is about the planning of the Naturalis in the Netherlands, and the outgraph is much better, was much better than me in visualizing diagrams and chart flows of how the planning process can visualize. It works very well. And the LEM report is available on the NEMO website, if you are interested. I put also two other quality museums, a book about quality evaluation. And I think it is on Google Books. It was on Google Books, so for free. Of course, you find for free on the icon Museum Basics 2 for the ones who are approaching the theme from the beginning, say, to have is a nice sort of handbook. And you have put the two books very distant, relatively distant, 30 years or 35 years of distance, to have a look at the other side of the ocean. And one is a very entertaining book. Thomas Holding, who was the director of the Metropolitan before Philippe de Montebello, Let's Mummies Dance. It's a very nice book about how an American, big American museum works behind the scenes, not technical, but socially, say, the involvement of the board and so on. It's the person who created, among the other things, the cloisters. And the Stephen Cohn, do museums still need objects? This is recent, just very recent. And the title in itself puts a question which is destined to be for many, for the years coming, for the coming years, still very, very hot. And thank you very much. Questions, I suppose, if any. Okay. I'm reading the question, so leave me the time to read the question.
Yes,
the question about the use of technology and sustainability is very appropriate. It's very appropriate because I think we all experience this in our daily life. There is no need to talk about museums specifically, but in museums. I think that and we have experienced very frequently, I myself experienced very frequently, the sense of disappointment that, or the that you have, for instance, when it's typical. If you have in a museum 20 screens, and one is silent because something has happened, when you come back, the only one that you remember is the one which is silent, not all the others. Or it's like when in the restaurant you have a full three-course dinner, two courses are okay, but the third one is a disaster. Of course, you don't remember the two which are good, the two ones which are good. And this technology is evolving so rapidly that this risk is serious, but it is balanced by two other elements. One is the fact that, luckily, the cost of technology in general of devices in the last 20 years has always going down. So in other terms, a video projector, professional video projector, 10 years ago costed three times, I don't know, five times. And so, in one sense, you can a little bit balance the aspect in terms of updating. But again, there is a matter, a conceptual matter. In my experience, there are, for instance, a typical is what we have seen from Manchester, the Imperial War Museum. And it is, there are some technological aspects which can become classic in some sense. And even if they're a little bit old fashioned technologically, they still work. Not in they work because the slide project, the projector is working, but because the communicative system and experience works. Work, both the communicative experience and the idea. So we once said that it is true that sustainability is a critical point. On the other side, this could be our North Pole Star when planning in terms to find the good compromise between fresh technology together with a possible long-term technology, which could interpret what we want to tell, to say, and to offer. If you want intellectually, if you want spiritually, to the user. The another question, the narrative modes appear to foster an extractive model. Well, I don't, perhaps I didn't explain myself clearly. I don't think exactly an extractive model of exhibition. Well, the scope of participation of the user is it's one of the dilemmas nowadays, it not only for museums. Of course, there is a scope for the participation of the users, but under certain limits. And it is that it can be in the inspiration of the exhibition. It can be, of course, thanks to the mobile devices, on the spot when the things happen, the experience happens. But museums, this is my opinion, cannot give up to their own social responsibility. You are, a museum is a cultural institution. It has a responsibility. It says what it wants to say deliberately. Nobody, luckily, at least in a democracy, obliges the museum to tell one story or the other. And users are willing to participate, but users are also very much willing to be involved in a process, in a fruitful process. It's like on the internet. The problem is no longer the quantity of information. The problem is how to orientate yourself in the jungle of information. And, oh, congratulations, Lubeck. I would be very curious. I visited it many years ago. I wonder if it is still the same. It was very fascinating. I hope it is still. For my answer about the narrative and the instructive is the narrative for what reason? Just to tell a story? Or there is always a purpose. Mix of entertainment and education. Let's put in an emphatic way the growth of the personality. That you, when it's finished, you say, okay, I feel better. I'm better in the sense not that I'm happy or less happy. Do not exaggerate, but that it was not a waste of time. It was useful under many points of view. I think that the question about should the museum invest time and stuff in social media, unfortunately for the moment, is still a problem because, as you have said, is an alternative. Can I go back to a slide? Because I forgot to show a slide, which has to do with something that is suggested. I think that is inevitable, but it's for the moment for most of the museums, the small and medium-sized museum, it is true the social media are a very time-consuming activities, and you must have the skills. This is a question. About the narrative. Museums are oriented about towards storytelling, but not necessarily a curator has the skills for storytelling. Oh, you can love storytelling, but if you tell a story to your son, your grandson, and he's bored, it means that you're not a good storyteller. Or perhaps there is no future simply because the thing has changed so radically that one generation is no longer able to tell a fascinating story to the following one. About the social media and about all the other aspects, for instance, app, audio guides, and so on. Why I put these slides? Around the museum experience now, but not in always in a direct connection with the collection or with the concept. There are all the crucial problems of our society are in some sense taken in. So you have in big museums or in small museums involving to feel the migrants better, the problem of peace, the disaster of the environment, for the elderly people to improve the quality of life. There is a certain, I define it, the salvific syndrome of contemporary museum. And this is very much influenced by this idea of the museum as a militant organization. I don't have anything against that, but sometimes I ask myself after having visited a museum, one of these museums, or a museum, even the British Museum, with some aspects dealing with their activity. Is it necessary a museum, or this simply something that, what is the, I mean, you can find the same or activate the same process in a school, in a library, in an archive, in a social center, or in a street, or in a bar, or whatever, in several environments. What is the direct, what makes so special the museum, not in general, but to be so specially appropriated for this. This is the point, not so special. So special we know, but so efficient and special and efficient, yes, say, fruitful. And I don't think that there is a sort, I think that there is a sort of overestimation of the role of the museum. Do not exaggerate. We cannot save the world. We can contribute, but if you feel guilty because you feel that it's not done enough from the migrants, is not only, well, it's your own personal feelings, but do not, the museums have their own limits. And this, but, and here I go to some of the questions, it is true that all the great social issues find the great help in the use of the social, in the general communication of the social media and in general of the, all the digital devices, because it's based on words, on images, more than on objects and physical space, and could integrate very well the plans, the plan of the museum, of the museum activity in general. And of course, this it's a transition period. We honestly, if we are honest, intellectually honest, nobody knows well where we are going. So there, we'll see. Perhaps there will be a reaction back to the, like the American fellow evoked, always frequently these things happen. Perhaps we get the pendulum going back to the objects, focusing on the objects and leaving apart all the rest. I don't know. As the question, this has very much to do with the question, do you think interpretive panels are still useful? Well, yes and no, because, first of all, audio guides are dead, in the sense that, strictly speaking, because although they are still very popular, and they're popular not for a technological reason, but for a behavioral reason, that people like very much hanging and having this sense of solid something, and not again engaging themselves with this device, but this is destined to finish, and it's already finished. But the panels, I don't know, good old panels means another way of communication, which is reading. What it remains in both cases, audio guides, apps, and panels, unfortunately, is one thing. Is one of the most difficult jobs in the world to write texts, both for auto guides or for partners. And it's a skill that you learn for after a long exercise. Sometimes you never learn because it's a matter of inclination. There are people who are able to do that, others, and then so the core of the question is not. Simply the media, the mediums, say, panels or audio guides, but the skill in producing the contents. This is quite complicated. Digital storytelling, commitment, museum and citizen. Yes, of course, I think that is a good experience, but with a footnote. To be aware of the fact that digital storytelling remains in the digital sphere, and how to enrich the exhibition environment with the results of the digital sphere, well, it can be done, but we still are at an experimental level, not because we are, say, backwards, we are distant from the evolution, but because in all society, this in also in the all communicative system, this is something which is a complicated process which is developing under our eyes. This was the last question. Thank you. Yes, thank you for your attention.